Our second reading this morning comes from the book of Acts. And even though we are in the second week after Easter, this takes place after Pentecost has already happened. That day when what could only be described as the Holy Spirit coming like a wind and like flames on the apostles to drive them out and have them preach in languages that everyone could hear and understand. We're told on that day that many believed and many came to form part of that community, that first Christian community. Today's reading tells us a little bit about that life together. Let us listen for God's voice speaking through these words. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many owned land or houses, sold them, and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as they had any need. May God add a blessing of understanding to our hearing of these words. Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts and spirits be inspired by your Holy Spirit and thus made pleasing to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Last Wednesday, people gathered around the nation to commemorate the 50th anniversary of the assassination of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Marches, ceremonies and services were held in such diverse places as Memphis, St. Augustine, Seattle, D.C., even in London, England. But they recalled not only the tragedy, but the man and his message. As part of this commemoration, the King Center in Atlanta is in the midst of what they are calling a year-long MLK 50 Forward. They are holding events ranging from marches to calls to commit 50 acts of service, to symposiums to not only honor King, but to reignite action and passion for his vision, which went far beyond his famous I Have a Dream speech. For while MLK did come to national attention with the Montgomery bus strike and his I Have a Dream speech, and for its attempts to end desegregation and Jim Crow, that was only part of his wider goal. King believed that not only that there could be, but there should be what he termed the beloved community. And while Josiah Ross, who founded the Fellowship of Reconciliation, originated the phrase, it was King who brought it into wide public use. One of his first public mentions of the beloved community was during his 1956 victory speech as the Montgomery bus boycott ended. He stressed that the ultimate goal of this and a future nonviolent resistance is the creation of that beloved community. Later in his first book, King expounded that our ultimate goal is integration, which is generous, genuine intergroup and interpersonal living. For the aftermath of nonviolence is reconciliation and the creation of the beloved community. Later he would write, he saw a brief glimpse of this community as he stood in the airport after the end of the Montgomery March, as flight delays postponed for several hours most of the marchers' departures from the airport. As I stood with them and saw white and Negro, nun and priests, ministers and rabbis, labor organizers, lawyers, doctors, housemaids, and shop workers, brimming with vitality and enjoying a rare camaraderie. I knew I was seeing a microcosm of the mankind of the future in this moment of luminous and genuine brotherhood. Within this mix of races, professions, economic situations, King glimpsed for at least a brief moment that what they held in common as human beings brought them together in their diversity, but not in spite of it. According to the King Center, the center of King's beloved community is a global vision in which poverty, hunger, and homelessness will not be tolerated. Racism of all forms and all forms of discrimination, bigotry, and prejudice will be replaced by an all-inclusive spirit of sisterhood and brotherhood. There is far more to King's beloved community than ending segregation of the races or the races existing side by side in nonviolence. His vision envisions a radical reordering of how the world works, requiring not only a change in laws, but more importantly, a change in hearts and in the way of life. For even if legal desegregation was ended, King believed that true community could not be formed until what he termed the three evils, the evil of poverty, the evil of racism, and the evil of war, were fully addressed. And that's why he found himself in Memphis 50 years ago, supporting the sanitation workers of that city of all races as they went on strike not only for a living wage, but for safe working conditions. For King, it didn't matter what their race was, for he understood that their well-being was linked to his and to all of us. I wouldn't be surprised if our two readings today influenced King's conception of what a beloved community should be. For Psalm 133 extols the joy when kindred live in harmony, while the passage from Acts gives us a portrait of a community that appears able to do just that. In that passage, the writer of Acts describes a community, a diverse group from a wide range of nations and situations that had been drawn together by Peter's preaching of the resurrection and who were now one heart and soul. Now, I know that sounds like one of those too good to be true promises. You know, like shed 25 pounds in a week by eating only ice cream and steak. For how could they suddenly be of one heart and soul? After all, they were an assortment of different nations, languages, practices, even economic situations. Yes, they all had come to believe in the message of the resurrection that the apostles had shared that first Pentecost. But from that, they became unified in one heart and soul. And a sense of this being too good to be true may increase when the passage goes on and said, no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. Really? Because only a three scant verses after this, the author of Acts tells us of Ananias and Sapphira, who lied to the community that they have handed over all the proceeds from the sale of their land when they have held back a considerable sum. And then later in Acts, Paul is sent to spread the good news, yes, above the Gentiles, but also to gather a collection for the saints of Jerusalem who are poor. So what has happened to everything being held in common and not a needy person among them? Well, according to many New Testament commentators, nothing has happened to it. For rather than defining and describing a fait accompli, this passage reveals the goal of the community. In the original Greek, the tense is imperfect as it describes what they did as their actions of coming together and not a needy person among them. It indicates that this has started and is attempted, is ongoing, but is not yet finished. In addition, scholar Luke Timothy Johnson believes our difficulties with this passage often come from viewing this as part of a checklist of items that we need to complete in order to be considered a good Christian. Instead, Johnson calls this one of the diversity of mandates throughout the scripture. These mandates tell you who you are, not what to do. For it's through the shaping of that identity you then grow to discern, by the power of the Holy Spirit, which mandate of the many given in scripture is the best one to be followed at any given moment. Now, over history, this passage has been used to either support or decry different economic theories, all as being the true Christian one. But commentator Scott Hosey argues the way of life described in these verses from Acts goes beyond an economic theory of living. It is a response to the resurrection itself. This isn't some new command or some new rule. Instead, it's a genuine response to that news that Jesus has been raised by the dead, of God's victory over death in all its forms. Likewise, Pastor William Willimon insists that this passage from Acts is the most eloquent testimony of the reality of the resurrection. A group of people whose life together is so completely changed from the way that the world builds a community that there can be no other explanation other than something decisive has happened in history. Their purpose for sharing with each other isn't to meet some ideal where poverty doesn't exist. It's that they can't help but share, believing in this life-giving nature of God is reflected in the resurrection, and that has moved them to such a point that they want to make sure no one in their community is in need. Which is probably why this passage appears the second week of Easter and not after Pentecost. For it describes a group who have not only heard the good news, they have believed it and allowed it to shape their lives. The resurrection shapes their lives, not only as individuals, but as a wider community of people. All their practices of worshiping together, sharing the Lord's Supper, caring for each other, the healings they experience, all these tell of God's love for all life that brings out of death new life and shows that love is the ultimate power. Their belief that Christ is risen extends into an experience of that resurrection. This experience sparks in them what King described as what was necessary to form that beloved community, a qualitative change in our souls, as well as a quantitative change in our lives. Their unity, their attempts to ensure that no one among their group is in need, isn't an attempt to win God's favor or prove that they're good Christians. It's a gift of the grace expressed by God onto them that they can't help but share. Now, neither the book of Acts nor Dr. King believed that such unity would be free from conflicts. The unity forged by the resurrection did not erase their differences or their diversity. The book of Acts continues to tell of their differences of opinions, their conflicts and heated discussions that at times flared up in their new faith communities. Likewise, King emphasized that the plea for unity is not a call for uniformity. There will be inevitable differences. But Dr. King also believed that conflicts could be resolved peacefully and adversaries could be reconciled through a mutual, determined commitment to nonviolence. All conflicts in the beloved community should end with reconciliation of adversaries, cooperating together in a spirit of friendship and goodwill. For when we declare an Easter belief that Christ is risen, it states that in some unexplainable way, God has acted, raising Jesus from the dead in such a way that we can now see and recognize in each and every person that they too are a beloved child of God, and that they are our sibling in that family. We can do that just as Jesus did, just as God always has, does, and will continue to do. For being an Easter people, as Jesus' followers are often called, means that no matter what differences we may have, our unity is already a reality. Incomplete, yes, but a reality in which we can actually live. We no longer have to compete for the power or the resources or even God's love for us. We can see our unity in diversity through this Easter faith and through our actions. In this congregation, we are seeing this Easter faith in our work with Habitat for Humanity. For Habitat says it organizes different peoples and communities to build these structures, that they are also building within King's beloved community. For they say, as we build houses, we also build bridges between people of diverse backgrounds. We build paths to more connected communities. We build ways of all people to come together and share in the creation of a new world. We thrive together, or we wither alone. Habitat holds that the beloved community is fair, is just, is built on love. And not just any love, but as Dr. King said, the love of God operating in the human heart. That's a practical love that requires participation. When love is truly and fully present, it compels us to act. It is this love that is present in Easter. A love that declared through not only through words, but through God's action of love that we experience in the mystery of Jesus' resurrection, is a love that must continue to be enacted, bringing together diverse people in unity of that love, but not necessarily uniformity of beliefs and actions. In this time, in this world where there are bitter divisions and we're seemingly tearing apart people along ideological lines, is a love, a declaration that is desperately needed. Christ is risen. Our acts of love and our commitment to all living in relationship as God's beloved community, God's beloved family, declares that Christ is risen indeed. Amen.